Hello and welcome to today's webinar, Building Resiliency, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I'm the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services here at Georgetown. And our presenter today is Matt Paknis, who's a leadership business coach. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We had close to 200 registrants, so we're thrilled that so many of you are able to join us today. Before we begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's webinar is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 24 hours on our YouTube channel and website. There are two audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you're welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Feel free to close some of these applications or simply join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. Matt is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A component of today's webinar. We'll be emailing out a PDF copy of the PowerPoint slides shown during today's session. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. Matt has designed and delivered corporate development programs to identify and develop successful leaders and to form thriving teams for over 20 years. He is certified to facilitate several leadership style indicators and programs to help participants manage themselves, coach others, and to lead and measure team results. Matt's current clients include General Dynamics, EMC, Charter Care Health, Paso, Roe, Johnson & Johnson, Brown University, AT&T, emergency response agencies, public school systems, law firms, medical practices, engineering, and scientific firms. Matt studied organization behavior and architecture at Brown University. He also played football at Brown and then coached at Brown, Penn State, and the University of Rhode Island, where he earned an MBA in international sports management. Matt has instructed at Brown University, where he created and implemented the successful 50-hour-long Practice of Management Certificate program, the University of Rhode Island, RISD, Bryant University, and at the University of Massachusetts, where students selected Matt as their outstanding faculty member. He worked as a manager for financial services and telecommunication companies and was recognized for exceptional management practices. Matt also initiated the Brown University Alumni Association webinar series, and we're thrilled to have him join the Georgetown webinar series today. Matt, I want to thank you in advance for sharing your time and expertise, and I'm going to now turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Emily. And it's very nice to be able to spend some time with you all this afternoon. I thought it might be wise to start our discussion by just talking about what are some of the causes that generate stress and change in our lives that seems to be non-ending and ongoing. And so there was some research done recently that I read, and there are the three main driving forces, and I have one of my clients is EMC, and it's a unique business model that they're positioned in because they address all three of these factors on a day-in and day-out basis. But the first is people. There are now 7 billion people on the earth. We reached 1 billion inhabitants in 1865. 2 billion in 1974, 2 billion in 34, 4 billion in 1974, and like I said, we've just passed 7 billion. So as you can see, the more people we have in the world, the more opportunity for change. If there are only four families living in the proper area of Washington, D.C., but you had the exact same amount of roads, and I guess you've got the special subway down there, there would be no anticipation of traffic. But when you add so many more people to the mix, change is unexpected because people do things out of your control. And that's really one of the biggest factors. So they say that we're going to have about, I think, 10 billion people on the earth by 2040. That's not going to reduce. The more people we add to the mix, the more unexpected change. In addition to that, people share information. And there's been more information produced since 1965 than in the 5,000 years that preceded 1965. And information is doubling every 3 years. Just think about the way you receive mail, maybe if you were around 25 years ago, 20 years ago, just got regular mail delivered to the house. They were usually bills or actual letters. now we receive an inordinate amount of junk mail at our regular mail spots. And then when we come inside, we have voicemail and email. And we often are attached to a cellular phone or apparatus that gives us constant updates and constant contact with people, such as text messaging. When we people get together and they share the information, the natural byproduct is the third factor of change, cause of change, and that's technological advances. And according to research, 90% of the world's technological advances have occurred since 1900. So if we just thought back 111 years ago, well, we wouldn't be able to have this session as it's being presented right now. If we were to have a meeting, it would probably be at a town hall or a church or a community center. Those three often were all one and the same. Probably traveled to the meeting via horse, although cars were available. They were usually just in a city area. And we'd probably be heating or lighting the facility with either candles or just window light and a fire. So as you can see, it's been a tremendous acceleration of change, particularly in the last, say, 15 to 20 years with the technological advances that we've experienced. As a result, our lives are more complex now than ever. And a lot of people complain of just being overwhelmed with too little time and too much stress. So today's session has been put together to help you deal with this. So often, if you've ever swum in the Atlantic or Pacific Ocean, tried to ride the waves or surfed, and if you get out there and you try to stand and just oppose the wave, it knocks you over, sends you over head over foot, and you end up with a sandy bathing suit. The goal and the recommendation by experts is rather than take a fight or flight syndrome in response to any sort of change is to align with it, to partner with it, and to move on. So today's program is really about three main buckets. It's about helping us see where you are, so you can acknowledge what situation you're in, to become a little bit more self-aware and to give you some tools for self-awareness. In turn, the recommendations from experts for being able to manage change boil down to two major clumps, and that includes having real clear goals and a support network to help you accomplish those goals. So we're going to break that down a little bit further so you can get an appreciation of how this can actually be applied to your life. To give you an idea of what change makes you feel and how it makes you feel, if you could, if you're wearing a watch or if you're wearing jewelry, and it's possible, take the jewelry off your one wrist and put it on the other wrist, or take your jewelry off of your fingers and put it on the other hand. Or if you're clasping your hands or your arms are folded or your legs are folded, just flip that, and you'll see that those patterns that you've established for years, often people put their watches on the same wrist every day in and day out, or the same jewelry on the same fingers day in and day out. When those patterns are disrupted, that's discomfort. And if you amplify that, you can get an indication of what it feels like to be under constant change and constant stress. And if you don't know how to deal with that on a regular basis, it can be an undermining factor in your being able to live a fulfilled life. There's a list included in the packet that was handed to you, and it includes Thomas Holmes' list of life changes, and it starts the most disruptive change in anyone's life is the death of a spouse, and that would be equivalent to, say, 100 stressor points. Well, if you exceed 200 points in a six-month window, your life may be overwhelming, and you can get stuck and locked in a valley, and we'll go over that in a second. How do you get out? Well, before we do that, we'll talk a little bit about self-awareness and the Johari window. Johari sounds like it's an Eastern philosophy, but it actually is a combination of the two first names of the gentleman, Joe and Harry, that created this practice or this tool. And what it does is it gives you an insight into comparing what you know about yourself with what others know about you. And we know that people that are more resilient tend to have a higher level of self-awareness. So in other words, they're taking that area. If we look at this block and the two columns are dedicated to the areas that you know or don't know about yourself, and the two rows from left to right are what others know about you or what don't know about you, you have these four quadrants that make up your awareness as compared to the awareness others have for you. In the upper left corner, we have the open arena, and that's an area that's obvious to you and that's obvious to other people that know you. So it's your public persona, it's who you are, it's what we all agree your strengths are, the areas that you need to or would like to work on. The area to the right of that is your blind spot, and our goal today is maybe to help you, or to hopefully help you expand that blind spot so you have a better understanding of who you are and what you need to do in order to become more resilient. We've put some factors and some competencies together that experts state make a resilient person. If you can help assess those and determine what areas you'd like to work on, ideally you'll leave with a game plan on how to become more resilient. On the bottom left is the area that's the hidden area or your secret area. It's a facade. It's an area that you keep private from others. And then the area down on the bottom right is the unknown, the capacity or potential. And we all have that. Every person listening today and who will review this material does something better than 10,000 other people. And the key is, how do we find that? Education is supposed to give us that insight. Sometimes we're not as fortunate, but everybody has a naturally inclined talent or gift that they're able to do better than, on average, 10,000 other people. There's an interesting story that came up in the paper I was reading. I'm an avid sports fan, and I read a couple different papers, and I was reading one about a young man named Innocent Jacob in Rhode Island, and he was from, I think, Namibia, or maybe from Zimbabwe, and came to live with his uncle, who was getting his PhD in Illinois. And his uncle took a job in Rhode Island with Amgen. And so this young man with his cousin were in high school just trying different sports. I think he was a freshman in high school. And they went out for track. And the track coach suggested, hey, why don't you try the long jump? So the boy was about 5'9", 5'10", and he went down and did the long jump. And turns out he jumped about 21, 22 feet, and he came back, and the coach asked him, how far did you jump? And he told him, he said, well, no, I can't believe that. It's not that far from a national record distance. So the coach went down and had him jump again in the coach's presence, and sure enough, the next five jumps were all about the same, all between 21, 22 feet. And the next thing he said, well, you're so good at this, why don't we try you in the high jump? His first high jump, he cleared 6 feet 4 inches. And within a year, within 6 months, he was clearing 7 feet. Had the coach not suggested to Innocent Jacob to try the long jump or the high jump, he would have never known what his talents were. And so the recommendation is, you know, in addition to expanding your own skills about who you are, there are things out there that you probably don't know about yourself that can bring great gratification and joy to your lives. I just, last year, after a 30-year absence, started picking up singing again, because they have such a wonderful program at our church, and it led to my being trying out for a barbershop quartet. Now I'm getting paid in gigs in less than a 10-month period to go out and deliver these barbershop concerts. And it's just something I never knew I really had, but I recommend to everyone out there that there's something out there that can help you reduce stress, because when you use your highlights, when the whole concept of being self-aware is when you're able to identify your strengths and highlight your strengths, you're going to be putting your best foot forward. In turn, if you're a manager, if you have a high level of self-understanding and self-awareness, you have a framework from which to better understand other people, and it makes you a much more effective manager. People that tend to have higher self-awareness tend to be more motivated, more energetic, more positive, and they're more successful just because they're able to put themselves in a position where their strengths are highlighted. And so, particularly related to the topic of self-resiliency and being able to move forward, we've put together some competencies, and these are the competencies. Part of these are Daniel Goleman's competencies, which I'll reflect on in a second. But in general, here are 12 competencies that would constitute a person that's able to bounce back from setbacks on a regular basis. Not everyone takes some time to reflect and adjust after a change, but most healthy people are able to adapt and adjust and move forward when they can. Now, these competencies are in a grid that you can break down in sort of like a four quartile style or assessment after the session, and it'll give you an indication of which areas here that you need to work on in order to become more self-aware, more effective in your capacity to be resilient. Referring to Daniel Goleman's work, just listened to him on the radio last week, actually, but he wrote a book called Emotional Intelligence, and in that book he argues that your EQ is a greater predictor of professional success and happiness than your IQ. And he does a lot of comparisons of presidents. For instance, the president with the highest IQ in the modern era is Jimmy Carter. I think his IQ is over 180. But as far as his effectiveness as an administrator and a leader, and I don't mean to get political, but if you just look at the outcomes of his presidency, he was not that effective. Number three on the list is Richard Nixon. I think he was number one in his law school class. But again, although extremely bright, very high intelligence, not an effective leader or manager. Number two on the list, ironically, is one of your alumni, and that'd be Bill Clinton. And it was interesting about Bill, when the book was written, he was in office, and Goldman made the observation that this is an exceptional person. It looks as though this is someone who has not only high IQ, but it has its balance with EQ. The one area he was concerned with was under motivation, and it was self-regulation. It was impulse control. And as we saw prophetically, sometimes his impulses got the best of him. But with these traits, the trait that Goleman believes is the most important for professional success is that self-awareness, is that capacity to know yourself inside and out, know your talents inside and out. Again, we put together this list of competencies that all relate to resiliency, being able to stay positive and focused, being able to look ahead and predict and plan, being able to stay somewhat organized so you can access things and feel like your life is organized and structured, being able to be flexible and adaptive enough so when changes do come, you realize there's a backup plan and you realize there are things you can do to manage the situation. I've included all of Goldman's skills in here, his social skills, being able to connect with others, read groups, the capacity to empathize and understand and appreciate, to listen. It was interesting on the radio the other day, he said, what's the one thing that's really keeping managers and leaders and workers from being most effective? And he said, really, it's probably that capacity to listen. There's so many stimuli coming at them from so many different angles that it's very hard for people to sit back and just stay focused on what another person is saying. Your desire to drive for influence, we've put a couple in here. There's an interesting study by Haymick Burr. They're a competency profile company up in Boston, and they'll go in and they'll look at different positions in an organization to determine who are the exceptional performers, and then they'll create competencies based on common traits those performers share that can be learned or applied to others in the role, or can be identified in the selection process. And what they found for managers in particular, or good workers, is a high drive for success, and meaning they just will never give up. They just want to keep plugging, and a desire to problem solve. If you have those two traits, we can plug in any job, individual contributor job, and most men at frontline management jobs in an organization. The distinguishing feature is that desire to influence people in a very positive way, so they leave a situation feeling much better than when they entered it, and they feel very good about it because of the influence the person had on them. Well, to create some goals and to become self-aware is probably the foundation to know where you're at, to acknowledge where you're at. And in order to do that, I think it takes a look at who you are and what your talents are. Here's the Bridges model, and it complements another theory called the Oz theory, where the distinguishing features between someone who's surviving and thriving include a person that's just waiting, is waiting for help, blaming others, has some personal excuses, and may not even know they're in denial or they can't acknowledge the situation they're in. As you become and have the capacity to become more thriving and to pull yourself out of that surviving mode, the first step is that acknowledgement, being self-aware, looking at things realistically, looking for alternative solutions, picking a solution, and then moving forward, getting on with it. In the Bridges model here, we see that as you're moving along, and I'm going to use a little dot here, you're coming along and all of a sudden there's this change, an unexpected event that happens. I was at a program a couple of years ago, and I was driving home, and there was some work on the highway. So I came to a complete stop. I was in a passing lane, and I was just, it was a beautiful sunny day. It was a Friday afternoon, and I was couldn't wait to get home because we had some plans for the back porch and barbecue, some adult beverages. And the next thing I know, I was hit by lightning, or I thought I was hit by lightning. As I mentioned, it was a sunny day. And as I came to, I realized my car was askew in the road, and you know, I looked up and looked back, and I could see behind me there was a young driver with a face all bloody, and I'd just been hit. So I had a complete stop. The other person had been texting and just barreled into my car at about 35, 40 miles an hour. Fortunately, I was in a VW Passat, and I had minimal damage. The front end of his car was destroyed. But I went through a time of all of a sudden resistance. I was looking forward to getting home and relaxing and having a great weekend. And now, all of a sudden, I was like, oh, no, I don't want to be here. I want to be relaxing. I don't want to have to deal with this. I got out of the car and saw my car could be moved, but I realized I had to call a lawyer. I had to call the police. I had to call my insurance company. I had to get everything done, and there were people rushing by. Then I had to deal with this young man who was in bad shape. And I was just, oh, no. And then I started, it was ironic that a friend actually drove by and stopped and asked if I needed a hand. And that sort of picked me up, and it made me look forward. And I started saying to myself, okay, what do I have to do to get things moving? And I realized that I had to make those calls, had to contact my wife. The police came, took a look. We got things straightened out. And we... came to an agreement, shared our important information, and moved on. Now, this another story I like to use that really highlights these stages and the importance of that green dot. That green dot represents a goal or a clear vision of where you want to go. What's it going to look like when you succeed, and by when do you want to do that? When do you want to incorporate those things? So you're going along and all of a sudden there's this unexpected change, and you want to be resilient, but if you've had so many changes and there's this is the last one, like these people, these blue dots sort of represent valley dwellers. And what happens with valley dwellers is when they see that you've had a change, they want you to join them because misery loves company, and there's strength and validation in numbers. So they'll tell you, oh, life stinks. I can't believe that happened to you. They want you staying focused on whatever puts you there, so it'll keep you down and keep you connected with them. I mentioned that Thomas Holmes list from earlier that's in your packet. If you exceed 200 stressor points in a six-month period, there's a chance that you can get stuck in the valley here. If you get stuck in the valley, basically you're frozen or compartmentalized into the past situation, and you really can't look forward. You're just sort of stuck in your own misery. This can happen to PTSD victims or survivors of extreme traumas. The brain chemistry and the actual changes and adjust in their brain, so they become in constant either defense or fight mode, and they can't really function at an optimal level to move forward. The goal of a person that's healthy is to go through, because we all go through a time of adjustment or reflection after an unexpected change. Once you're there, to look and explore for opportunities to move forward, get a goal, and then move ahead. in the 1950s, a woman, a swimmer named Florence Chadwick, became the first woman to swim the San Francisco, I'm sorry, the English Channel. Then she was the first woman to attempt to swim the San Francisco Bay. But the day that she started swimming the bay was very cloudy and foggy, because there's a lot of fog often in San Francisco. The water's very cold and the air is always relatively warm, and when those two forces hit one another, it creates a lot of fog. So she got in her boat, and she had two boats trailing her, and she started swimming, and every time she took her head up out of the water, she saw nothing but fog. And it was just a plain, thick pea soup fog. And she kept swimming, but she got about a minute away from the dock where she was supposed to land, and her muscles seized up. All those stressor chemicals, cortisol, was firing nonstop and triggered, and she couldn't control it, and it actually, they were firing to a point where her body no longer functioned optimally, and she had to be pulled out of the water by the two boats that were trailing her. Well, she had some resolve, and she went on a clear day, and she took a picture of the dock where she was supposed to land, and she scheduled another swim. She said, I'm going to give it a shot, because she was so close to making it the first time. So she got in the water on the second day, and she took her head out of the water, and guess what kind of day it was? It was more foggy than the first day. So she starts swimming, and she takes her head up, and what does she see? Well, she had taken that picture, and she put it in her room, and she studied it every night and every morning until that picture became galvanized in her head. And every time she took her head up out of the water now, even though in reality there was a lot of fog in the air, when she looked out, she saw that vision, that picture. She had her goal so clear and confirmed in her mind that she kept on swimming, and in fact, she made it. Not only did she make it, she was the first woman to swim the distance, but she also broke the time record. She swam it faster than any man had ever been able to swim the distance. So the importance of having that very clear goal, combined with the other benefit that she had two boats trailing her, and they weren't valley dwellers. So in other words, while she was swimming, they weren't saying, well, you're never going to make it, the water's cold, it's full of sharks, you better get out. They were saying, you can do it, give it a shot, keep going, you're almost there, you're on pace. And so surrounding yourself with people who can give you those kinds of insights and support and encouragement is critical. And we're going to go on to that right now. Wanted to look and just review this tool with you. If you are looking to become more resilient, we know that people that have more energy and are a bit more productive tend to have life balance. And this is a good way too of being able to assess different goals in your life. These are really the 8 major areas in anyone's life. And if you have balance, tend to be more energetic and more productive. And so let's look at these 8 different components a little clearer, and we'll usually do this by assessing Kramer from Seinfeld. Kramer's a relatively healthy guy. He swims in the East River, eats a lot of peaches, smokes cigars occasionally. He usually gets about a 7 or 8. So if we went out, if 1 meant in the center here means needs a lot of work, and a 10 means highly satisfied, say Kramer's probably about a 7 or 8 regarding physical health. Regarding fun and recreation, Kramer's off the charts. Always scheming, always planning. Kramerica, adopted the highway. Pretty good level of friendship. We don't know a lot about his family other than his mom, who enters the picture at the very end of the series. If Kramer were to rank himself, he's not a stressed person, and the real locus of control in anyone's life is within themselves. Two people could be experiencing the exact same life circumstance. One could be extremely satisfied with their lives, his or her life. The other person could be very dissatisfied. It all depends on your locus of control and your perspective. Kramer considers himself a player, but most people that are in our programs feel as though his romance is relatively low. finance, he's always mooching, although there is rumor that he had a trust fund towards the end of the session. That's not confirmed. He had the apartment in Manhattan. Your environment is your living and working conditions. He had the chicken sign, the hot tubs, the drawers, Merv Griffin studio. It was a nice apartment in Manhattan, although it had some concerns. Kramer really doesn't have much of a career. And most people would agree he's a pretty happy guy. But if we put this wheel on the car, we wouldn't get too far. We'd get stuck. So our goal is to look at the area that's probably most close to the center, because all these different components are somewhat interrelated, and to ask ourselves three questions. Is his inability to improve this area, is it a willingness, able to, or allowed to situation? There are one of three reasons why people aren't able to get something if they want it. It's an ability issue, a willingness issue, or an allowed to issue. Well, we know he's allowed to work in Manhattan. He'd been on-strike bagel worker. He apparently has the ability to work. He does have some focusing issues, but I think we can get him a job in Manhattan. Right now, it's his level of willingness, and it appears as though he's somewhat ambivalent. He's not obstinate. He's not compliant or committed, so he's ambivalent. He's not really sure what he wants. But if we were able to get him in a job and a career that he was fulfilled in Manhattan, obviously his finances would come up. He'd have a work environment in which to work. He might be able to meet some people, although I think we'd have to work on some other areas for Kramer. He'd meet some new people, might be able to visit his family more regularly. They might have a wellness program, and he may even be more satisfied. And we put that wheel on a car, although it looks a little oblong, we'd be doing a lot better. And that's the whole idea of balance and fulfillment. Now, if you're dissatisfied in any of these areas, it's most generally causing stress, because the gap between where you'd like to be or expected to be and where you are is really what causes the level of dissatisfaction or stress in anyone's life. So these are eight factors in anyone's life that are either going to cause a great level of satisfaction if your expectation is aligned with your reality, or dissatisfaction if your reality is if there's a gap between your reality and level of satisfaction. So now we're going to talk a little bit about how do you bridge that gap. If you are in one of those areas and you'd like to move across, there are generally five things that make up that gap between where you'd like to be and where you are. So again, here over on this end would be a job for Kramer, satisfied in Manhattan. And right now he has no job. So if we were to amplify this arrow in the middle, it would look like this. And there are generally five different areas. You have a planning stage, a vision, what is success going to look like? What does that dock look like? And by when do you want to do it? If we refer back to the Flo Chadwick example, there's a problem space, there's a solution space, and there's implementation. And at any one time, you can determine where's the most advantageous place to be, or where are you. So let's say I wanted to lose 10 pounds, and I wanted to lose it before Memorial Day this year. Well, my plan and design stage is to say, okay, what weight am I now? Where do I want to be? Sorry about that. And the vision would be, okay, I want to be able to fit into all the clothes that I wore when I was a senior in high school. Solution would involve diet and exercise, and that could get a little more specific. The problem is I may not have the time or the energy or the encouragement or the specific goals that I need to have written down. So anytime you're trying to implement something, you could be in one of these five spaces. And the key is, if I'm in that problem space where I don't have someone, I don't have the energy, I might have to get a training partner that keeps me on task, that keeps me going. And then I can determine, okay, do I need to go back to the drawing board and maybe readjust my goal? Is it only 5 pounds? Or do I need to be inspired by my vision of, you know, looking fit and feeling as fit as I was when I was in high school and being able to fit in those clothes? Or can I just return to the solution space to make it through? Now, regarding change, the key is to always unveil the problem. And one of the best ways to manage change, and here's our three questions: are you willing, are you able, are you allowed? Once you isolate that, it's important not only to be able to ask yourself, and I bounced forward a little bit, try to unveil what is the obstacle in getting in your way. In 1993 and 1994, GM went from a $7 billion loss to a $4 billion profit, $11 billion turnaround. And they credit that turnaround to returning to Japan after they went there in the early 80s to study the auto industry to see what Japan had done to turn their industry around. And they thought they had heard that goals was the most important thing. So they went back when they were failing and said $7 billion losses. And the experts in Japan said, well, no, we didn't say goals. We said the key is to figure out, after you've got your goals, why aren't you able to make and achieve and accomplish your goals? So this little walkthrough is intended to help you isolate what are the key gaps or barriers getting in the way of your goal. What's the root cause of that obstacle? How can you overcome that root cause or do away with it? What steps can you start today to get away with it? And then within 30 days, how can you assess progress and what will progress look like? So that is complements this model here. In addition to that, we need to have relationships and effective support systems in place to keep us on track and to keep us going, so we can turn to people that we trust, and trust is defined: if I'm in a vulnerable position, I know this person's not going to let me be hurt. So those relationships really support the way we feel about the other person and the dynamic of the situation, which in turn improves the way we act towards the situation, which in turn usually improves the results. If you've ever worked in a big office building, inevitably there's someone that people will try to walk around or circumvent in order to avoid contact. And so that relationship impacts the way you think about carrying out your work in a given day, which actually influences the behaviors, which ultimately will undermine results, because it takes a long time to walk around and to sort of like avoid that person. On the other hand, if there are healthy relationships in an organization or an office where everyone feels a high level of trust, like they can connect with one another, they will reach out to one another. That in turn influences the way they think about each other, which promotes positive actions and activity, which ultimately helps you solve problems and get to solution much faster, which is ultimately going to help your results and in turn further support positive relationships. A good way to help you determine what is the level of health in an organization is by using and referencing this Eric Burns model of transactional analysis. People that are resilient tend to maintain this adult-to-adult perspective. According to Byrne, everybody has these three core components of their personality. Everyone has a parental role model whose memories they assess when they want to make decisions, when they want to evaluate, when they want to nurture. Likewise, everyone was a child, so when you want to have fun, when you want to play, when you want to have humor, you access healthy memories of that child. And everyone has this capacity to be a mature, rational, objective, realistic, mature adult. And Byrne would suggest that you spend about 75 to 80% of your time at this adult. And when you want to have fun, you flip down and you experience the child. when you want to have a when you want to nurture yourself or analyze something, you access healthy memories of this parent. And then in turn, when you're dealing with another person, ideally you want to maintain this healthy adult-to-adult assertive dynamic. Well, if that was the case, why doesn't everybody act this way? Why aren't we always working not only to help ourselves get ahead, but help other people get ahead? Why aren't we always co-equal in our dynamic and discussions? Well, and why, if this is the case, why is Oprah a billionaire? Well, it's because not everyone had an ideal parent or an ideal childhood. And so if your parent was overcritical of you or others, these filters connecting these two areas can be contaminated with those criticisms, and you're going to prejudge yourself and others the way your parent did. Likewise, if your child had too many fears, your capacity to rationalize like a mature adult is going to be contaminated with those fears, and you're going to be delusional about your experience. And I'll bring up Bill Clinton again. You can't see me, but many people over the years have told me I look like Bill Clinton. And I was in a business about 15 years ago where I was about to gain a new client, and I thought it was a great fit for my services. It was a high-tech firm, and they were looking for ways to identify future leaders from their population of workers. And sat down across from the president, he just started shaking his head almost in disgust. And I was like, oh my God, something's really wrong here. So I used my tools, you know, I said, hey, I can see you're shaking your head a lot. And I guess something's wrong. I don't know. He goes, you look just like Bill Clinton. And I said, well, I've heard that. And he goes, you even sound like him. And I said, well, I haven't heard that. But, and he goes, and then he said the deal breaker. He goes, I hate that guy. And no matter what I could have done, even though my tools and my applications, my programs are probably very good for his firm, there's no way I was going to be able to help him because he wasn't listening to Matt Paknis. He was listening to Bill Clinton. And so he was probably looking at me with these filters, critical filters, and he was angry at me, but he was prejudging me, but he was also probably somewhat fearful in that he was living in this passive-aggressive, fearful child-parent mode. But anytime we interact with someone without our knowing, and the value of communication is how it's received, not how it's intended. I went there with just open slate. I was trying to help him. Inadvertently, I reminded him of someone in the past because we don't look at people as they really are. We most react to our memories that they evoke in us. And the key to being able to be resilient is, regardless of the situation and people and the triggers that are out there, to stay in this adult to adult. Because anytime you run into somebody, there's a chance could trigger any one of these other responses based on how you sound, on how you look, and on the other person's perception. Often the one we see crop up in organizations is this parent-child power control criticism fear dynamic, where someone gives someone feedback and that person then turns around like Henny Penny and runs around and there's a gossip, oh my God, I'm going to lose my job, we're going to lose our jobs, no one's any good. And or you give that feedback to somebody, and they say, oh, really, why don't you sit down, I'm going to tell you what I think about you. And it becomes that hostile sort of positioning, aggressive to aggressive positioning. By focusing on the facts and being as objective as possible, you're best able to maintain that adult to adult. So with that said, that's sort of like in a nutshell, how do you maintain resiliency? By focusing on goals, by cultivating healthy adult to adult relationships, and by breaking down and looking at things as objectively as possible. Those are the key elements that we found, at least in the research to date. There is two other stories that I was going to share with you. One is by Verner and Smith. They were a couple that actually studied for over a 30-year period children, you know, on the island of Kauai. And they chose Kauai. It's our westernmost county in the United States, in Hawaii, because it's a closed population. And there are also very high rates of alcoholism, poverty, and suicide on the island. And they wanted to study kids that had grown up and grown out of that very negative environment to live happy and fulfilled adult lives. And after a 30-year period, there were three trends and three factors that trended and showed that they had a significant difference on whether or not a person was able to become a happy, fulfilled adult. The first was the people that were most resilient and able to come out were folks that did not have a sibling born within 2 years of their birth. So those first 2 years of undivided attention by a caregiver, had a significant difference. And we see this carry over to the animal kingdom, where chimps, the normal gestation period, I think it's 5 years, if they have a sibling born within that five-year period, the older chimp usually doesn't make it. The next was that Brazilian people had a unique talent or skill. Some, they were cute, they were artistic, athletic, academic, something shown through that enabled them to really succeed. But those two factors, whether or not someone has a unique talent or whether or not someone had a sibling born within the first 2 years of his or her life, those are things we can't really impact by the time someone gets into the work environment. What we can impact was the third factor, and that was these resilient kids had one person, usually not a family member, but had one person who took a very sincere, well-intended, well-meaning interest in their overall well-being. They had mentors. And so, again, building that mentoring relationship is so critical. And then on the flip side of that, we know that if you can be a mentor, that's one of the most fulfilling things in life. I was born on the day John Glenn orbited the Earth, and I had the opportunity to meet with him a couple of years ago, and I had my picture taken with him. And he was giving a talk on happiness. He had just gone up, back up in flight. I think he was 77 years old. Kennedy actually had to change. They had to change a law that Kennedy enacted, making him a national treasure so that he could go back up into space. He had just returned from that flight at the age of 77. He was talking, what really makes people happy in America? And he said, three things. The first is, happy people make a significant contribution to something, a cause larger than their immediate family. They're involved in a community. They're involved in helping other groups. There's some larger cause that they really are inspired by. Number two, happy people find and utilize their unique talents, their unique gifts and skills. And the third thing is happy people tend to make a significant, well-intended difference in at least one person's life. And so having those goals, but also cultivating a strong mentoring relationship are the two things I can leave you with, and I hope that you're able to do that. And if you have any questions, feel free to give me a holler. Here's my contact information. You can also contact me. I'm sure Emily has information at the university that she can forward to you as well. Appreciate the opportunity to spend some time with you this afternoon. And if, again, I can help you in any way in your own endeavors and in helping you become more resilient, feel free to contact me.
Thank you so much, Matt. We've gotten several questions, so I'm going to go right into Q&A. We have someone that has been in the valley stage for a number of months following some extreme life stressors, and now they're beginning to move beyond it and formulate solutions to create positive change. However, they question their resiliency and feel fear of falling back into the slump. What are the common pitfalls that prevent people from getting out of the valley effectively, and how to best avoid them?
Well, you know, there also is, you know, there are real medical issues that could be involved there. And so I think you want to make sure if you have a trusted physician that you could go to or a specialist to make sure that there aren't other factors. But a lot of times if people are under extreme circumstances for long periods of time, the actual brain chemical, I'm not a doctor, but I know this, their brain chemistry will change, and it will keep you from being able to get out and have that well-intended, well-being, that good feeling. And so getting a normal checkup and being checked on that end, I think, is very important. Once that's okay, because you could be knocking your head against, well, you could have a great support network, you have your goals, you have all your talents laid out, and it just doesn't happen. I think you got to make sure that the engine's tuned up properly. Does that help?
Yes, great, thank you. Someone wanted to know if you can repeat the name of the person who had the parent-child adult theory.
That's Eric Byrne, E-R-I-C-B-E-R-N-E. It's a transactional analysis. He's a classic practitioner. I mean, he's no longer with us, but his models are transcending. They apply to all different generations and applications. He has a bunch of great books that are about communication.
Thank you. Follow up to the previous question we asked related to discussing how to not fall backward. Can you go back to the slide with the keys related to breaking through resistance and maybe just elaborate just a bit more? It's an interesting point for people.
Yeah, so what I'm hearing is that this person is moving up, but then they get pulled back. Now, the theory here would say, in order to keep going, you have to have that real clear goal, but you also want to try to break away, if these folks are present in your life, these negative valley dwellers, and surround yourself or cultivate a group of positive support network that are very encouraging. The other thing is you want to make sure that your talents are aligned with the goal, and you do that with getting strong and accurate feedback from people that you really trust. And so cultivating that network of experts, and without knowing the specifics, it's hard to really recommend, but because I don't know the detail or the difficulty level of what you're trying to accomplish, but getting some feedback from people that are in that area, I think, is really critical. Again, the other thing is to make sure that as you're moving forward, that your own body, that your own balance, that your health, your recreation, your getting back to the wheel, making sure that all these components are in pretty good shape and you're pretty satisfied so you can be up for the task of moving forward. A lot of times what pulls people back are the valley dwellers, but also it's a lack of clarity and really lack of belief. And so really feeling totally connected and aligned through your identity, through your success, through feeling in control of being able to accomplish this success. Those are the real three components. Interesting, another study by Tom Peters, he asked people to rank themselves in four quartiles. This has to do with motivation, their ability to get along. And 100% of the 25,000 people polled felt as though they belonged in the top quartile in regards to their ability to get along with others. Is that true? Do 100% of the people strike you as being able to get along, 100% of the people that you come across in a given day? They feel that way, but it's not really true. The next was leadership skills, uplifting, evangelizing, inspiring. What percentage felt as though they were up in that top quartile? 70%, only 2% below average. So 98% feel as though they inspire, uplift, energize. Is that true? Do 98% of the people that you come across inspire you? The last one was athletic skill. Over 60% felt as though they had more agility, strength, endurance, coordination, wins than the other. It couldn't be more than 50%, only 6% below average. So 94% felt as though they were more athletic than other people. What's interesting about this study is that we all yearn to be winners, and we all strive to be winners. The key is being able to put yourself in a position where your talents and your goals are such that you feel in control of success, you feel as though whatever you're doing is reinforcing your core identity, and you feel as though you're being recognized by that success. And so getting that kind of feedback and encouragement and guidance, I think, is really critical to keep you from being pulled back from the right people, from surrounding yourself with the right people, but also having that real strong picture of what success is for you. sorry, I go on these tangents. I hope that wasn't too much there, Emily.
Thank you for the elaboration. Very, very helpful. Another question we have, which I'm sure other people on the phone can relate to, we have someone that works in an academic environment, which is filled with conflict, and just sounds like a toxic environment. How would someone best function in this with resiliency and good intentions despite not having control over a toxic or conflict-filled environment?
Yeah, you know, that's the kind of thing where you sort of look for these very short-term wins. When we're dealing with anybody that's under a real stressful situation, you want to sort of say, okay, how can I compartmentalize and get down into that moment where I can control the next moment, where I can just be in the moment, mindful, rather than being influenced by all these external factors, extraneous factors that might be so negative. And one place would be, one of the great things that I think you can do is, if you're surrounded by all this, you don't have to participate. It's not a forced entry, but it's hard to avoid hearing it. And what you can do, a lot of people create like mental vacations, or they take pictures and they visualize, they meditate, so that they can think of themselves in a much more positive arena, or a place that they find very appealing and enjoyable, and they can sort of remove themselves mentally from that situation, if that's feasible. I'm envisioning you're sort of like in downtime. When you're actually engaged in a classroom or with students, you're probably very in the moment, but all the other stuff, when the downtime, when you go to get a coffee or when you go to the cafeteria, that's when you hear all these things. And being able to sort of remove yourself, or having indicators that can help you click away, like on an automatic remote control, can often work. And then just working to, you know, cultivate relationships. There's got to be some people there that are like you and probably see things the same way and would rather not be so negative and toxic. And if it can't, then, you know, making those positive steps towards getting into an environment where that is more apparent.
Thank you. Great response. So we have time for one more question. This is interesting. Do you have any suggestions for helping build resiliency in others, and in particular, younger adults?
Yeah, I think those traits that we had talked about a little bit earlier, if they can do some activities that are, and giving them feedback, see if you're trying to influence and inculcate and help people cultivate these traits, you could give that kind of same side of coaching feedback to people. Modeling, I don't know the direct relationship or what the nature of the relationship is, but if it's a parent or if it's an older sibling, modeling these behaviors is probably one of the greatest things you can do to help another person become more resilient. You know, people learn by seeing. And if you can act this way, it's probably very, very effective. Then giving the person the opportunity to practice these things, you know, putting them in situations either at home or in the neighborhood where, you know, there's that's why sports, I think people use sports maybe overblown now, but I always loved it as a microcosm of being able to handle situations that then I can relate to and transfer later on. It was a great way for us. Granted, when I was in sports and growing up, we didn't have parental involvement. It was only the coach. So a lot of the ownership and a lot of the responsibility fell on the shoulders of the players. And you were able to practice a lot of these things and a lot of these skills. I think that's, you know, without sending the person out on their own to face the world, but giving them environmental considerations where they're able to practice these things is important. But if you have constant exposure to that person, demonstrating these things is probably the greatest thing you can do.
Great. Thank you so much. Matt, this has been such a valuable webinar with many, many concrete takeaways, so I want to thank you so much. And before I turn it over to you, I'm just going to remind everyone we'll be sending a follow-up email in just a minute with a copy of the PDF slides and also the resource handout, just in case you didn't receive it yesterday, and also details on how to get in touch with Matt, and a feedback survey if you'd love to get your thoughts on today's webinar. Matt, thank you so much for sharing your time and expertise. I'm going to turn it over to you to close it out.
Well, I really appreciate everyone's time, and I think that the story that resonates with me, I love the story with Flo Chadwick, just being able to, as she's crossing the San Francisco Bay, which is cold, which can be filled with sharks, nothing else was on her mind but that picture at the end, and she had those two boats that with the people that were constantly encouraging her. And so I encourage you all to get in your own San Francisco Bay and to strive forward and to not give up, but to keep plugging. And ultimately, you know, the person that just is in there constantly chipping away, and is surrounded by the right and well-intended people, you're going to make it. You're going to do fine.
Great. Thank you so much. We hope everyone has a great day, and please join us for other webinars in the future. Thanks again, Matt.
Thanks, Emily.